Okay, so. Sabrina?
Yep.
Java?
Yep.
She told me how to say her name. I'm very proud of myself. And I looked at her background when she, I never know who's coming from the sponsors to speak. And when I saw her background, I was like super excited because I worked at Watchguard, as you guys know, in networking. And it's just she has a great background. And so she can probably provide you with a lot of great information tonight. And things that Cloud Health is doing is really interesting because if you've ever worked in a large environment and try to manage that, it's challenging. So I'm gonna let you take it away.
Awesome. Hi, everybody. My name is Sabrina Johal, and I'm a solutions architect at Cloud Health Technologies. And the session today, the session between you and home, is leveraging a cloud policy framework from zero to well covered. What does that mean? It means an approach to looking at governance at scale. So what to expect from the session today? So we're going to give you some more context around, you know, what is the problem that we're seeing across, that we see across a lot of our enterprise organizations and customers that we work with. We're going to propose a solution in the form of a cloud policy management system, and then also talk about some best practices that we at Cloud Health leverage and other best practices that we've seen across our customer base. And then look into something like governance as code. And then look at an example of how you could codify, say, a policy into and deploy that across your organization. And then also the next steps, how do you get started on that? So what is the problem? So to give you some context, if you talk to our chief architect at Cloud Health, when we started as a company a few years back, he could tell you that, you know, we started with one Elastic Load Balancer. There were two web servers, named Web Server 1 and Web Server 2, and they were running on M1 smalls. And then we had an SQL medium database on the back end. And then we knew exactly what ports what were open. We also knew exactly what security groups were in place. And as we grew and scaled, we expanded our customer base. You know, if you asked him that same question today, he wouldn't be able to answer it off the top of his head. He'd have to look at something for a reference. So the approach that we had for governance at, you know, earlier on is not something that we would be able to use today. And when we talk about governance, we need to think about it as a thoughtful, as you're scaling up, you need to think about it as a thoughtful, deliberate approach that you want to put in place for your organization. What is governance? So it's a very generic term. So we are calling it people, criteria, processes, tools to ensure secure, effective, and efficient use of IT resources. What do we mean by efficient? Efficient is any cloud resources that you have up and running, they're well utilized, and are at the same time delivering highly available and secure applications, customer applications. What do we mean by effective? Effective is any investment of IT resources that you might have in terms of people, time, money. It is aligned to your business goals. And what we see, if you look at this chart here, up here, if you can read it, is that a lot of organizations, as they're scaling up, try to solve this problem by throwing people at the problem. And what we find is that it's usually untenable, it's error prone, and it also gets expensive. And so what we're proposing is that you need to have automation backed by good processes to solve the problem, not people. And the rest of the session is going to talk about, you know, how do you get to that, how to get started on that. So if you buy into our premise that technology, not labor, is the solution, then you need to start thinking about certain things before you get started on your governance posture. You can't improve your governance posture if you are not measuring it, or if you don't have a way or means to track it or measure it. So you need to have some sort of continuous monitoring in place. And I'm not just talking about traditional operational monitoring. I'm talking about anything, any resources, or anything that is aligned to your business goals in the cloud. So it could be your RA coverage, it could be your cloud costs, it could be your efficiency or utilization of your resources in the cloud. And then once you're starting to monitor and track that. You need to be able to track that over time. So as you make changes into your, you know, into your posture, that you're able to track the success of those changes over time. You know, what happened when and what were you doing before. You need to start thinking about, you know, capturing some business criteria. What is it, what rules do you want to apply that would align into your cloud infrastructure that would align to your business goals? If you're looking at a policy-based management system, you need to look at, you need to look into, you know, policy by managing by anomaly, where if there is an anomaly detected, that you take a remedial action. You need to start thinking about, you know, putting some processes in place. So what is it that would give you, you know, maybe you need to start, by approaching it with looking at cost optimization, or you need to start approaching it by looking into security, or fixing security, or putting rules around security. Whatever it is that would give you the easiest or the easiest way to get stakeholder buy-in from across your organization to drive the policy and governance. And then once you have these, you know, once you know what, you know, your rules are, and then once you know what your processes are going to be, then you start thinking about automating some, putting in automation in these workflows. So you don't want to, you want to make sure you have these in place before you start automating, because you do not want to automate bad processes. And then as you are fine-tuning and working on, you know, building these policies and rules, you want to start leveraging best practices. There's best practices that AWS publishes. There's best, can you guys hear me in the back, or is it too soft? Okay. There's best practices that AWS publishes. There's, you know, Cloud Health. We also have, based on our experience with customers and our own organizations, we have some best practices that we publish as well. So there's industry standards as well to look at. So the journey to governance is not a single step process. And as I talk about these different phases of governance, of the journey to governance, think about where you are as an organization on this pyramid and what you need to do in terms of moving up the pyramid. So everybody starts at adoption. So adoption, you could be an expert in all the AWS services that you're running in your environment, but still be in the adoption phase if you have, you know, unexpected AWS costs, you have no optimization in place, you really don't know what workloads, the workloads that you're spinning up, how do they really align to your business, and how do you account for them for your business goals and values. As you move from adoption to scaling, you're looking at you know, adding additional workloads, but you're starting to put a little bit more visibility around your costs. You're starting to put some cost optimizations or some optimizations in place for your infrastructure. You're starting to, but you still don't know, you know, you don't really have any automation or workflow, or you have some simple policies in place. From scaling, when you move up to a well-managed environment, you have visibility into your costs. You can tie back your ROI to your business. You've got optimization in place, and it's a good place to be because you have visibility. But some of the remaining questions that are left are, you know, around, you know, the remaining questions would be like, you know, how am I, you know, am I staying optimized all the time? I could easily be drifting out of optimization if I'm not going in and checking in all the time to see if I'm optimized or not. So you don't really have automation in place. And it's a good place to be, but to go from managed to well-governed, you kind of have a very good idea of exactly, you know, how your workloads are aligned to your business. You have automation in place. You have full transparency across all of your different business units and applications. And you've put in people and teams in place to enable and drive those governance rules and policies that you want to enforce in your organization and you want everybody to comply with. So how do you move up that pyramid? So if you take away nothing from this presentation today, this is the one slide to take away. And this is going to just talk about all of the different steps and strategies to think about as you're trying to drive governance in your organization. What we've seen across our different enterprise customers is they want to make sure that you give your users and teams the freedom to deploy whatever resources they want to, start whatever resources they want to in the cloud to do the work they need to do. But you also want to make sure that they, you know, follow and they comply with specific rules that you want to drive in your organization. So a top-down governance approach. So decentralized management, but centralized governance. And typically to drive this kind of approach, what we see, we'll see you know, a specific role or a team that these enterprise organizations will put in place, like a cloud steward or a cloud custodian. It might be somebody from the cloud ops team. It could be some customers have called it the center of excellence team, where they have this whole team of cross-functional people, you know, working together. So sysadmins and cloud ops and DevOps engineers all working together to make sure that they have a well-optimized cloud infrastructure environment running in their organization. Just out of curiosity, how many people have heard of this role or have a role like this in place in their organization? So once you have these cloud steward or cloud custodian roles in place, you want to make sure that you know they are going to be the evangelists in your organization to drive this governance across your teams. But you also want to empower them to institutionalize some of these policies and rules that you want your organization to comply with. And as they're trying to enforce and institutionalize these rules, you want to start thinking about some of the toolings that they might need to have in place so that the information and the data sets that they're trying to show the teams, they're able to give the full transparency and show the teams where they're compliant, where they're not compliant, and what they need to do to bridge that gap. You also want to be able to have a tool in place where you can aggregate all of your different data sets. So it could be your cloud cost data, it could be your performance management data, it could be your asset inventory from the cloud. So you want to have a tool in place for these teams as well as these, as well as this cloud custodian role where they are able to centrally manage all of that. And the easiest way once they have, once they're capturing all of these rules and policies in place would be to codify some responses, you know, create some responses that you want to take as part of the compliance violation into a, you know, run book so that, well, that they can, you know, that they can have, they can press, they can deploy across a different your entire organization and see and show people what they need to do. And once you have, you know, say remedial actions and responses to these violations in place, you want to have some automation in place as well to automate the workflow for these policies. And we'll talk a little bit more in detail about, you know, what I'm talking about here, where like the automation will be, typically what we see is in two phases. First, customers will have the policy-based management system to send out an alert, and then they either integrate it with their existing approval workflow systems like Jira or ServiceNow, so that system generates an alert, it goes into Jira, they take a look at it, then they execute the actions that the system's recommending based on that. The second phase you see in the automation is, you know, once they see that there's appropriate responses coming from the system, and they feel that they've been validated over time, they start looking at just enabling the system or giving the system, empowering the system with the authority to just take these actions on their behalf and also send them an alert saying, we took this action, we saw this violation. And the last piece of all of this is you've got all these policies in place, you've got all this governance enabled, but how do you measure the success of it? So you want to have reporting visibility around it. You want to be able, and you need to have different types of reporting visibility. You need to be looking at the operational level, so what was happening, when in time for historical tracking. You want to give your business units and teams a visibility into exactly how compliant they are, what is missing, and how they can bridge that gap. And then you also need to have like an executive overall view. As an organization, how compliant are you with the rules that you've put in place? So some of the challenges that we see as organizations are trying to enable these policies and rules in their environment is around, you know, different environments or different environments is a bad word over here because it's on the slide as well. Different teams within the organization will have different needs for these policies that you're going to put in place. It's not going to be a homogenous environment. It's not going to be a homogenous policy system. So for example, if you were looking at a segmentation by environment for a SaaS vendor, you'd be looking at, say, you know, production, staging, QA, and research environments that you've got, right? So what policies that would work for production might not work for research and the other different segments in there. For example, so in production, it's the one that's the most sensitive, it's the one that gets the most attention, it's also the one that's the most expensive. So you want to be able to track your costs. You want to be able to track the rate of change of costs in some of your services. You want to make sure that there's tight security and compliance in place. You want to be able to see, you know, looking at your metrics, that your resources are well utilized, that you're not your teams are not over-provisioning your resources. But something like that might not be applicable for somebody in research. So if they have to jump through hoops to play with some data and play with some tools to just get to their S3 bucket, it's going to be frustrating, and it's going to be against the purpose of what they're doing in the environment. For staging, on the other hand, there might be some different rules. So for example, in our cloud health backend infrastructure, our staging environment is used by developers when they're shipping out multiple features in a month, and then you just need multiple staging environments. So we know it's a variable workload, so we might not really care about the rate of change of, you know, the costs in the environment itself per day. But what we really want to track around is we have a budget. So if the staging environment is within a specific budget, we're all good to go. If we're going above a budget, then we should probably look at what's going on in that environment. Something like QA, again, in the Cloud Health backend, we have a simple test cycle that a developer goes in. Not a simple test cycle. We have a test cycle that's for 30 minutes. If a developer goes in, checks into it, after 30 minutes, once the cycle's run, you know, it throws out an output. So we might, the one thing that we would really care about in that environment would be that if our resources in QA are running for more than 4 hours, somebody needs to be alerted, because that doesn't seem right. So again, just to give you some flavors of, like, you know, what are the different policies you might be managing within your own organization, but for different teams. And we can peel it back one more layer. So even within production, you might have different groups looking for different policies that would be applicable to them. So for example, within production, you might have BU1, which is like your legacy application, which has a very stable workload. You want to make sure that the costs are not going up and down too much. You want to make sure it's secure, the security and compliance piece of it is in place. You might want to look at your RI coverage to make sure that, you know, it's covered particularly and it's optimized. Whereas BU number two, what might be your new and fast-growing app. So you know, because it's fast-growing, you really don't want to look at costs as much or worry too much about costs. But you might want to look into optimizing and making sure your resources that you're running in that environment are well-optimized, are highly utilized, are not over-provisioned. And the third one might be an acquisition that your company might have made. And you've just got the basics in place. You're going to slowly try and roll out some policies in place as you integrate them into your environment. So different requirements even within production for your different groups. So some best practices to think about as we create these, or as you're thinking about creating these policies for your different environments and your different groups. So within Cloud Health, we published this online on our website, as well as we have blogs on this. We've categorized, we've created six different categories for these best practice policies. So they fall under financial management, and I'm going to walk through all of them to kind of give you an example of some policies to think about. Under financial management, it would be something like you've got a budget, and you're looking at the budget at the global level for your organization, but then you also have team-level budgets, and you want to make sure if your projected cost for the month is going to blow your budget, you want to be alerted on it. Cost optimization would be around if you have, say, for example, an EC2 instance running for more than 400 hours during the month on on-demand usage, you maybe want to consider it as a candidate for RI coverage. Operational governance would be around cleaning zombie infrastructure. So if you've got unattached EBS volumes that you need to probably terminate, you have snapshots older than a year, maybe you need to start cleaning that up a little. Performance management would be around, you know, you're looking at your CPU, network, memory, disk utilization, and making sure that your resources are well utilized. They're not sitting idle. asset and configuration management would be around if you're using tagging as a way to allocate ownership within your environments. You want to be alerted if an EC2 instance is spun up and it's missing specific tags or if it's completely untagged. Security incident management would be around IAM. The one that we like to talk about or emphasize on is the one around CloudTrail, where you want to turn on CloudTrail for all regions, for all accounts that you care about, as it becomes critical for incident analysis there.
What do you peg your violation?
And you can be, it depends on like the response that you're trying to say, right, that we generate out of the system.
What's the brand of those, like, if I have a partner, I have a partner, I have a partner.
Yeah. So it would really depend on how you, what repository responses you want. So it could be anything from, and I'll cover this later as well. It could be just an email alert or email to the owner. It could be terminate this instance. It really depends on how you want to define your response to that violation. And we leave that, in Cloud Health, we leave that up to the customer to define that response. So what is a policy? A policy is simply a rule, and it has four key components. The data that it's being operated on, a clearly defined condition, if the condition evaluation is true or false, and the action to be taken. Our Cloud Health model is more around, you know, you can have a desired state condition, or you could have condition by anomaly. So we do, if we do by anomaly-based detection, so if anomalous found to be true, take an action. And it's easy to read that way. And the typical workflow for a policy execution would be you would have all of these multiple data streams coming in, and you create a rule. Each rule is a policy. And then you set a trigger. A trigger is when do you want this policy to execute? It could be, you know, Monday at 3 a.m. is when I want this to execute. And from there, you evaluate for the policy to be true, or true or false. If it's true, what remedial action do you need to take? So if we peel back this layer into the different components of creating a policy, it becomes a little bit more complex. So when you're looking at inputs or data sources, it could be coming from a variety of different places. It could be your cloud asset inventory. It could be your cloud costs coming from your builds. It could be your metrics coming in from performance management systems. You could even have synthesized inputs as well. So you're looking to check if your budget is going to be blown out of the water this month or not based on projected costs. So you need to have a place to calculate all of that and then check against that data set as an input. For triggers, you could have schedule-based triggers. So I want this to run on Monday at 6 a.m. Or it could be event-based. If an EC2 instance is spun up and it's untagged, send me an alert. Or if an EC2 instance is just spun up, untagged. State-driven could be if my QA is running for more than 4 hours. Let's set that trigger. So rules is just performing, and then you have a rule in place for that. So if you perform some logic on some of the input data, it can be a composite with many conditions, A or B, A or B or C, and C. And then the last piece of it is the remedial action that you want to take. Is it, you want to have a repository of actions, so the response that you were talking about, asking about. So it could be email the owner of an asset, or it could be terminate the instance, or it could be invoke a Lambda function should this violation happen. So what we're proposing is codifying some of this workflow into codifying this workflow so that way you have all of this data, all the four components that we were talking about, the data, the input data, the trigger, the rule, as well as the action in one place for your teams to look at and interpret and read, and also create frameworks across your organization that you want to drive and customize them for your multiple target teams that you might have out there. You want to make sure that's portable and universal, and also use it as a system of record or tracking what you were doing historically and how you evolved over time. And if you need to roll back, should you make an error, you can roll back to that as well. Centralizing your definitions of policy, your policy definitions, actually gives you consistency and it gives you economies of scale. So now I'm going to walk through an example of like from based on like the cloud health code methodology of what it would look like if you codified a policy. So I'm using one of the examples from one of the CIS recommendations. So most of you probably are familiar with it. It's the Center for Internet Security. They publish you know, there are these recommendations on how to run securely run your AWS environment. And one of the recommendations is around if your credentials are unused for more than 90 days, you want to make sure that you disable them. So this here is just looking at the PDF that's online available as well, you know, what the recommendation is, the description, and the rationale behind it. It also walks you through how to run this audit, and it's a multi-step audit. And the last piece of it is the remediation process, which is to remedial action, which is to disable the access key. So if we had to codify this, I'm going to just show you and highlight different parts of the code to look at the snippets. So the very top is the header. This is where you've got the name, the source, and the authors. If you're trying to share it across with multiple people, you know, it's easy to identify. The middle part is just documentation. If you want to codify this into a, if you want to integrate this into a run book, you can just write all the descriptions here to describe that, so it's easy to read for other people. And this is where like the parts of the policy creation come in, the components, the inputs. And in this case, it would be the AWS access key. The trigger, since this is an example, we said check it twice a day at 6 a.m. and 6 p.m. And the rule is if it's not used, send in the last use date as the attribute from the AWS access key. And because it's a date, you can call a function called age and days that you can apply an operation for a self-defined threshold. In this case, it's 90 days. And the remedial action is to disable the access key by invoking a Lambda function that passes in the parameters of the AWS access key and the ARN. And there you go. So some things to think about when you're looking at codifying governance or codifying your policies. You know, you want to, you know, start simple and then evolve as needed. And then manage it like, you know, like any code. Put some version control in place and then leverage best practices as you share them in the community library or in an open repository.
So if one of your customers has their access control limit and the customer wants to deactivate that, what do you guys do?
Our platform, we don't do that, but we will be able to alert you to do that. But you could write a code in vocal Lambda function that would actually do that for you, and you can use the policy response system to say invoke this Lambda function should this validation happen. So the last piece, once you have all of this policy-based management system in place, you want to ensure, you want to make sure that you can track its success. So the way to do it, again, like I mentioned earlier, is to have visibility and reporting around you know, three different tiers. The operational aspect of it, you know, you're historically tracking what was happening when in time. The business unit level, where you're giving your teams the visibility and transparency of how compliant they are and what they need to do to bridge the gap to where they need to be in compliance. And then the executive overall level, where you're looking at, you know, as an organization, as a whole, how compliant you are. And to recap how to get started, you know, start thinking about capturing those business rules and processes that you want to put in place that would align to your business goals. You need to start looking at, then looking into automating some of that workflow once you have these processes fine-tuned, and then leveraging best practices. And that's it. Thank you. Any questions?
Does Cloud Health have any cheat sheets or get started guides for governance that you share?
Yeah, so like those best practice policy management, yes. And if you go onto our platform, if you log into our platform and you have access to our platform, we'll actually walk you through some sample policies as well.
Okay.
And if you do a trial with us, we'll definitely set you up with some, you know, variety of sample policies to look into.
At what point in the scale of an organization do you see as kind of like the the entry point where they would use your solution?
So really, because it is a SaaS solution, it really is for anyone. But if you are at a point where, you know, you really are not able to, you know, you have some costs and you want to just get visibility and align them to, say, you know, how much is app A costing me versus app B, and what's my ROI, how do I justify it to IT or finance? If you're getting asked those questions, it's probably time to look at us.
Where are you guys with GDPR?
So we have, I think, some data privacy, and some certifications already in the bag for our platform. It's all on our website.
Okay.
Because we get asked that a lot. So like the EU privacy policy.
So, yeah, the GDPR goes into effect May 25th.
Okay. So I'd have to check on that one to be completely sure, but
sure,
we do have some data privacy stuff already in place for the platform.
Okay.
Do you guys know about patching?
Sorry?
Do you know about patching or just patching?
It's more
costs.
Yeah. Well, costs, and then like we'll give you some overall security recommendations, but then again, like we don't go into your system to, you know, fix it for you unless you give us the permissions to.
So we're looking at logs.
So yes, we integrate using an IAM role. Any other questions?
I just want to mention that I was just reading around. There's a free trial. So you can get some trial.
You can go to apps.cloudhealthtech.com to sign up for a free trial.
Thank you.